So certainly the current treatment of mantle cell lymphoma is evolving with the arrival of new therapies. Probably in Canada, the preferred frontline, I think, is probably bendamustine and rituximab. Once a patient relapses, there can be quite a bit of very young patients, I think, are still going for autologous transplant and first complete remission. But for those patients who've had just BR and are too old to undergo transplantation, then depending on length of response, there can be different treatments are given. Certainly, patients have a very, very long response could be eligible for second treatment in BR, which is not generally available in Canada. A lot of patients probably be offered R-CHOP, but because it's a generally older and more frail population of patients, ibrutinib increasingly is becoming the preferred second-line treatment. It's not that ibrutinib does not have side effects. It does have a variety of side effects. Of greatest concern to hematologists is bleeding and a cardiac signal primarily associated with atrial fibrillation. So there's interest in alternative molecules, BTK inhibitors, that may have a different safety profile. So today I'd like to tell you about the report of a phase 2 study of a new BTK inhibitor, acalabrutinib, in a group of patients, mantle cell lymphoma, who relapse or refractory. And as you may know, ibrutinib's been very effective in treatment of mantle cell lymphoma, so there's a lot of interest in new molecules that inhibit BTK in this group of patients. So this is a study that, with a median follow-up 15.2 months, and a little bit over 120 some patients who relapse refractory with a median of two prior treatments. The median age was around 68. The MIPI score in this group of patients was about intermediate high and about two-thirds. With the overall response rate was really quite high, it's in the order of about 80%. Complete remission rates were about 40%. The follow-up, of course, for the primary endpoint of the study was actually overall duration of response. It's about 70-some percent at 12 months, with a progression-free survival at 12 months of 67%. In terms of the safety profile, roughly a third of patients experience headaches, diarrhea, myalgias, fatigue, very similar to what we've seen with ibrutinib previously. In terms of bleeding, roughly a patient five had some minor bleeding episode. There was a single patient who had grade 3 bleeding from GI bleeding, but this patient did have a previous history of gastric ulcers. Overall, the safety profile looks quite similar to ibrutinib. One difference to point out is that in this group of patients, that only a single patient, in fact, had atrial fibrillation, no patients had atrial fibrillation, but one patient, in fact, had hypertension. So the conclusion, I think, to this is that acalabrutinib looks highly effective in this group of patients. Of course, it's not randomized against ibrutinib, but the results in terms of efficacy look comparable. The safety profile looks very similar to what we've seen in terms with ibrutinib, for example. The only thing that came out is perhaps a cardiac signal with a short follow-up looks a little less, and it'll take further time to know. So it'll be an interesting molecule to follow over the next year or two, and we'll see how well it competes.